Hello, good evening. You're watching News 360 from the News Hub at Adisawe in Accra. My name is Porsche Agabo.
And my name is Lisa Moni. The headlines for tonight is up in a moment.
News 360 headlines is brought to you by...
And number of persons feared dead at Kintampu waterfall in the Bonahafo region.
We'll go to the central region where cholera outbreak imminent at Gomwa Brofuedu community as some residents resort to open defecation.
Also in the headlines, Kasua Broadcasting Road gradually turning into a death trap. We will tell you why.
And also in this bulletin, more than 260,000 people in Ghana have hearing impairments.
And international news will go to Germany, and Social Democrats candidate Martin Schulz vows to fight populism if his party wins the elections due in September.
We have details coming up shortly. Do stay with us. We first begin from the Bonahafo region, where a number of persons have been killed at the Kintampo waterfall. Well, according to reports, the incident occurred at about 4:30 p.m. on Sunday, March 19, when a huge tree ran off the top of the waterfall, descending on dozens of revelers who were swimming beneath the fall. Officials of the Ghana National Fire Service and the Ghana Police Service arrived at the scene trying to rescue persons who were trapped under the tree. And joining me on the phone line is Assistant Divisional Officer Grade 1, Edukumi, who is the Acting Kintampo Municipal Fire Commander. Good evening and thanks for joining us, sir.
Good evening, madam.
Can you confirm the number of deaths reported?
Okay, actually, for now, we have 20 reported victims.
And they're injured?
Now, we have 20 reported victims.
Okay. And the injured, can you give us an update on that?
Injured, we are now counting around 11 injured.
Okay. And can you confirm what may have caused this incident? We understand a tree from the on top of the waterfall fell on revelers.
Exactly. The waterfall is being surrounded with thick forest. That's huge trees. So this afternoon, around 15-20 hours, that's around 5:20, there was this thunderstorm that blew around the waterfall area. So unfortunately, the students were in the waterfalls where they have the river swimming. So the tree broke and fell on them, on the group of students. So instantly, 18 of them reported as a result of the fell tree.
So most of the dead, were they students?
Most of them are students.
Okay. And the injured, which hospital are they currently?
They are currently at the Kintampo Municipal Hospital. So those whose injury is very intense have been transferred to Techimai Holy Family Hospital.
What's the current situation at the Kintampo waterfall? Has the place been cordoned off?
Yes, please. So far, now the police has taken over the place and then they are making sure there's peace and sanity at the place.
Well, thank you very much. I have been speaking with Assistant Divisional Officer of the Ghana National Fire Service, Acting Kintampo Municipal Fire Commander, and he just confirmed that 20 people, most of them students, have been confirmed dead, and they were at the Kintampo waterfall.
Now, the Gomwa-Profiedru community is likely to experience cholera outbreak. This is because women in the area have resorted to open defecation. Our reporter, Lucy Amila, has been following the story and has filed this report.
This poor structure is a toilet facility that served both male and females at Profiedru. But the female side has broken down for years now. The wooden one that was created also broken down. The women have no option than to defecate in the open and also through the use of black polythene bags. Though the community is embarking on a 22-seater toilet facility at an estimated cost of 130,000, lack of funds has slowed the pace of work. The Gwamtwahin of Gomwa Profiedu, Nana Bonzi Esuman, said the situation is worrying to the community, recalling how people had suffered cholera in the past years. The situation is similar in Gomwa Mangwate, a neighbor community where the news team spotted a dish containing human excreta. It was left uncovered. The refuse dump is also close to houses, and people complained it's a threat to their health. However, the chief of the area, Nana Okofo Ojefu Amwako III, and the unit committee chairman, Philip Danso, lamented flood and erosion have also been a worry. Another challenge residents noted is a frequent knockdown of children on the Agona Swedro Winneba stretch, and called for speed ramps to be constructed on the road.
Away from the central region, poor sanitation conditions have been a worry for governments in the country. Choked gutters have sometimes been the cause of flooding, killing many in the process.
Sanitation sector in Ghana faces a number of challenges, including very limited access to sanitation. Per UNICEF, 3 out of 5 Ghanaians practice open defecation, adding that Ghana could take 500 years to eliminate the practice due to the slow pace at which strategies, laws and interventions are being implemented. Walking down the streets of Accra, you're overwhelmed by all the trash that litters the city. To help deal with sanitation challenges in Madina, a suburb of Accra, students of mental and other health institutions in Accra, in collaboration with the Lankwantana Municipal Assembly and Zoom Lion, embarked on a sanitation and health education exercise. Registrar of Nursing and Midwifery Council of Ghana, Felix Nyante, advised the residents to keep the environment clean as a preventive health measure.
As some of us are actually deserting the gutters, others are engaging the shoppers and the shop owners and the traders and the sellers in health education, basic personal and environmental hygiene, so that we can prevent diseases and illnesses. We think that if we spend just a little effort in health prevention, health promotion exercises, we'll prevent a lot of diseases and we'll spend less in curative health services.
He was also worried about the recent incident of suicide in the country.
Because the mental health nursing school is involved, they are engaging the shoppers and the shop owners in basic mental illness education. We go through a lot of stress and people think that ending their lives is the solution. But suicide, they are telling people that it's not the option.
Some residents at Madina Zongo Junction have these to say.
So we've been doing it. And it's about people don't really partake in it. The former government also had these AMA people who do it almost every day. But they stop. I don't know.
Normally Saturday is our market day. Yes, nobody can leave his job and come and do gutter cleaning and those kind of things. So if something like that will be going, it needs to be announced, so especially to the houses, so that we get to know that maybe we need to come out to work to do something. But it seems that they only speak to the those who are in the stores. So sometimes we in the house, we don't know something like this is going on.
We appeal to the government to construct the gutters for us. When it rains, our homes get flooded.
And from sanitation, let's move to water. And the Ghana Water Company in the Eastern Region has issued a bill of 13,950 Ghana cedis to the management of Paso Lodge to pay or face court action. The hotel is reported to have illegally reconnected to the Ghana water pipelines after being cut off 3 years ago.
TV3 News guarded the hotel Paso Lodge was disconnected in December 2014 for its failure to pay water bills totaling 1,600 Ghana cedis, but officials detected it had illegally reconnected the facility to the pipelines of the Ghana Water Company. This was unraveled during a loss control exercise and backed on by the officials of the Ghana Water Company in Koforidua to uncover illegal connections. The Ghana Water Company Limited said illegal connection contributes to a chunk revenue loss estimated at 46%. The head of the loss control units of the Ghana Water Company Limited, Moses Adai Boateng, described how the team unraveled the illegal operations of the hospitality facility.
They have so many valves in the house. When we went, they have about four valves, that's stopcocks, fitted in various vantage points. So the moment they see Ghana Water car, they go inside and close those valves. So when we go inside, we don't see anything. But that day, I told my boys that when the moment the car stops, they should just run away straight away to where the power tank is located. That's where we discovered those stopcocks. And where the stopcocks were, they put so many things on those stopcocks.
Public Relations Officer of Ghana Water Company Limited, Kwaku Dase, said the hotel would be asked to pay the water used or face the law.
Since December 2014, they were disconnected. So all this while, the proprietors or the proprietor of this hotel have been enjoying or using our water free of charge. So you can imagine the revenue loss that is accruing to the company. We always want to entreat our disconnected customers that they should come and see how they can pay or defray whatever debts they are owing us.
He explained customers who have defaulted in payment of bills have a window of opportunity to negotiate with the company on terms of settlement and ask the public to support its outfit with information for a handsome reward.
Away from the eastern region, the Kasua Broadcasting Road leading to the Kasua toll booth is gradually turning into a death trap. Residents lament this year alone, 8 people have lost their lives through road accidents on the same spot. They are calling on the Department of Urban Roads to come to their aid.
Due to the absence of a road limit, most drivers who use the Kasua Broadcasting Road take no precaution. Due to this, accidents have become a common feature on the stretch. The news crew witnessed one on Sunday afternoon.
The drivers won't stop, no matter the number of attempts you make at stopping them. And if you make any mistake, you will lose your life.
Residents showed us evidence of some accident in the past. This woman is part of the 8 people who have lost their lives on the stretch this year alone. Her husband narrated the incident. She went to town and on her way back, just when she alighted at this junction and was crossing the road, she was knocked down by a car. Pedestrian crossing marks on the stretch have faded. As a result, people often have to wait for several minutes before crossing the road. There are no traffic lights. Even after this woman, 3 more lives have been lost here. The latest was yesterday.
We are told the situation is even worse on weekdays in the morning when school children have to use this road to their various schools.
Residents claim the current assembly promised to address the situation, but has still not fulfilled their promise. The stretch also lacks street light, making it difficult for drivers at night. We are appealing to the Member of Parliament to come to our aid before we take any unlawful action. Residents are appealing to the government to come to their aid to avoid the loss of more lives.
And residents of Bantama constituency in the Ashanti region are calling on city authorities and government to quickly respond to the deteriorated roads within the constituency. They say the deplorable nature of the road is hindering access to health care, particularly affecting pregnant women. A report by Benjamin Aidu.
Most linkage roads in the constituency have developed deep potholes, making it difficult to ply. Motorists and drivers learned the bad nature of roads is having a toll on their vehicles. Traders say business has virtually come to a standstill. Apart from the roads, the constituency is also faced with poor drainage system. Some assembly members in the constituency spoke to the news team.
We want government to urgently rehabilitate the deplorable roads and poor drainage systems in the constituency.
Meanwhile, Member of Parliament for Bantama constituency, Daniel Ochima Bwaje, has visited the area and appealed for support from government and other agencies.
We have major areas, about 8 additional electoral areas with rough road, as you have seen. And so we are pleading with the government and all the stakeholders. The roads are very, very bad. It's affecting development, it's affecting people's health, and we don't like it.
Engineer Peter Safo is the Bantama Sub Metro Roads engineer.
We don't have a good network in this area. We are very poor. We have a tiled road in this area. That's community also concerned. But in our office, we did our inventory. We are just waiting for funds and approval.
Let's now focus on crime, and three gang raiders suspected to have been terrorizing residents of Dintra in the Gasouth municipality and its environs have been arrested by the Accra Regional Police Command. The police have also rounded up a number of suspected criminals in separate swoops.
The police operation was informed by alleged spate of criminal activities in the capital. Recently, some youth ran amok over some disputed land issues, resulting in some people being injured at Dintra. 7 out of the 14 divisions conducted intelligence-led swoops simultaneously at identified criminal dens and hideout. The gun raiders, 28-year-old Mason Ibrahim Ado and Suleiman Muniru, also 28, plumber, were intercepted on motorbike possessing pump-action gun, pistols and rounds of ammunition at Dintra. The police alleged the gang was involved in armed robbery and land guard activities. The suspect reportedly admitted ownership of the weapons, but could not explain the purpose for which they owned them.
If the criminals would not sleep, we would not sleep. We would try to adopt all methods that will help us to prevent crime, to reduce the crime rate in the city.
Similar exercise at Mamprobi, Odoko, Tesano, Madina, Kaneshi and other divisions succeeded on rounding a number of suspected criminals for various offences. They are being screened and those found culpable would be put before court.
And an Accra Circuit court has remanded 8 suspected criminals rounded up by the Adenta and Abukubi Divisional Police Command. The 8 who were accused of robbery, break-ins, carjacking, drugs deal and stealing were identified by their victims during a public identification parade.
The Adenta and Abukubi Divisional Command of the Ghana Police Service has recorded more than 30 robbery, break-ins, carjacking, drug deals, stealing and other criminal reports within the first 2 months of this year. The development prompted the police command to conduct intelligence-led swoops at criminal hideouts within the jurisdiction and rounded up over 30 suspects. The police have also retrieved a number of home appliances, electronic gadgets, industrial cutters, arms and ammunition, stolen cars among others from some of the suspects. 8 out of the over 30 suspects were identified by their victims during an identification parade conducted by the police. The 8, including one who was almost lynched by a mob during the commissioning of a crime, have been remanded into police custody by an Accra Circuit Court. They were charged with various counts including conspiracy, robbery, carjacking, unlawful entry and stealing.
The court has also issued warrants for the immediate arrest of two of the notorious criminals, Raymond Crapper and Juan Christopher.
The public is hereby advised not to leave their homes unattended. They should also employ the CCTV camera system to monitor events in their absence. They should also resort to the use of domestic dogs to scare off these criminals. Above all, they should fortify entry and exit points by seeking advice from experts, that is police and other agencies.
The police has called for public support in dealing with criminals within the command.
And away from crime, the World Health Organization has estimated that more than 360 million people in the world have some form of hearing loss. The report also says most of them live in lower and middle income countries with little access to health care. Health Minister Dr. Kwaku Ajemanmenu, who disclosed this in Accra, says more than 260,000 people in Ghana have hearing impairments.
Hearing impairment is a disability that imposes heavy social and economic burden on individuals, families, communities, and countries. 80% of hearing impaired people live in low and middle income communities. More than 260,000 people in Ghana are deaf, according to a 2013 survey by Joshua Project. Children with hearing impairment often experience delayed development of speech, language, and cognitive skills. Hearing impairment and deafness in adults make it difficult to obtain, perform, and keep employment. Many are either dependent on their extended family for support or resort to immoral activities to survive.
Hearing loss or impairment poses a significant challenge in the livelihood of those affected and indirectly affect their families. Suitable care is required to prevent feelings of loneliness from stigma, exclusion, isolation, and frustration.
In a bid to reduce the burden, the Rotary Club of Ghana and Beirut Freedom Lions Club, Lebanon, jointly launched a hearing aid for Ghana. The project seeks to distribute 351-year aid worth $3,700 each among the needy in Ghana.
The Lebanese community in Ghana, recognizing their common bonds and interests, have initiated several projects to contribute their quota to the welfare of Ghanaians. This community stands to support any initiatives that would better the lives of Ghanaians.
President of the Beirut Freedom Lions Club, Raja Jabwo, and his Ghanaian counterpart pledged continual support for the needy in Ghana and urged all to join the crusade.
Let's now get more facts on hearing impairment. And according to the World Health Organization, 360 million people have some hearing loss in the world. That's 5% of the world's population, with 80 of them in lower and middle income countries, including Ghana, with little access to health care. And in Ghana, 260,000 people have hearing impairment. And according to the World Health Organization, out of this figure, that's 360 million people, we have 32 million of them being children suffering from some form of hearing impairment and hearing loss. Let's get more figures. And children with hearing impairments experience delay in speech, language, and cognitive skills. So these are some facts about hearing impairments around the world and also in Ghana. And Issa, the World Health Organization is also estimating that 1.1 billion of the world's population could get hearing loss as a result of noise.
Loud music.
Yes.
And other kinds of environmental noises. So, well, if you're a Ghanaian and you're watching, as we understand, 260,000 Ghanaians could be in danger. Maybe your family or mine could be. So let's watch out the kind of noise that we generate in our communities. Thank you, Portia. Now let's turn to some other stories in the news tonight. And Ngani is a community in the Yendi municipality of the Northern Region and has introduced new bylaws to protect girls from dropping out of school. Now, a man who impregnates a teenage girl in a basic school at Ngani would be fined 250 cedis, while bill teachers who are found culpable will pay 300 cedis. Let's have more.
Ngani community, located in the Yendi district of the Northern Region, is made up of Kokumbes,
With few dagumbes, farming is the mainstay of the people. The community has two basic and one junior high school. However, school pupils, especially girls, are endangered by some traditions which allow the girls to be betrothed to older men. Girls as young as 14 years usually drop out of school due to pregnancies. A total of 15 basic and junior high school pupils between the ages of 14 and 16 were pregnant and dropped out of school in the 2015-2016 academic year. It is against this backdrop that the Child Protection Club, constituting of girls, parent, school management and committee members, enacted bylaws to curb the situation.
We have a sponsorship program in the community and we are doing everything to make sure that children get the best out of school.
In the bylaws, teachers who impregnate school children will be withdrawn from the school immediately, while members of the school management committees will also have their membership revoked. In addition to the fine, the culprit will be required to pay for the antenatal expenses to be determined by the victim's parent before the culprit is arrested. The community has banned night ceremonies such as weddings and outdoorings and other social events which have been identified as contributing factors to teenage pregnancies. Headmistress of the school, Mary Magdalene Dieri, is optimistic female pupils will be protected if the traditional council ensure the bylaws are adhered to.
You said 250 Ghana cedis for impregnating a young girl in the community. Girl. I don't believe this.
And if you're a teacher and you are culpable, you pay 300.
You can't fight teenage pregnancy with this.
I mean, it's low, but maybe in Accra, yes, but in, you know, outside Accra in the villages, 50 Ghana cedis is a lot of money. So if you talk about 250, that's 250 Ghana cedis. I mean, 2.5 million the old Ghana cedis. It's a small amount of money, but it doesn't give you the right to do that. That's what the law says.
Well, what do you think about this? You can get interactive with us. That's on Facebook or twitter.com/news on TV3. We now continue with the rest of our stories. And a 19-year-old graduate of the Ghana Senior High School in the Northern Region is appealing for public support to save her life. Salamatu Abdullah has been suffering from kidney, liver and brain complications for 2 years now. Eva Atibuka spent a day with her in the Northern Region.
Salamatu holds documents from three separate hospitals. She has been diagnosed of kidney failure, liver and brain cancers. She has made painful trips to hospitals for examinations but lacked funds for further investigations into her condition. Salamatu is expected to raise 1,000 cedis for medication every 3 months. But with only a surviving mother who owns 2 acres of farmland, an uncle and aunt, raising the 1,000 cedis every 3 months is far from reach. She has therefore resorted to treatment at home. With all the complications, her health is deteriorating.
I used to go to Walwali District Hospital. They normally give me ulcer treatment. I took that medicine for more than a year. I never seen any difference from it. I went to New Life Hospital. They gave me same medicine. And I went back to teaching hospital. They told me that my problem is the liver, the kidney, and then the brain.
Dialysis would have been an option to sustain her till a transplant. But hopes and aspirations are dashed. Depression, pain, and isolation have now taken over her life. Organ donation and transplantation experts say Salamatu's condition is the most complicated and rare. That notwithstanding, family members are unwilling to help.
If doctors ask you to donate one of your kidneys to save Salamatu's life, will you do?
I'm just ready to do so. If I do not, who then will?
If donating any part of my body for her to survive, I am ready to donate.
but money to undergo further examination in a possible multiple organ transplant is a miracle hard to come by. Salamatu is appealing with philanthropists and corporate organizations to save her life.
And that's Salamatu suffering from kidney, liver and brain complications. And that's been going on for 2 years now. You're watching News 360, and let's take the weather update for now. And you're watching News 360. And a member of parliament is threatening court action against the government for what he claims is a breach of the District Assembly Common Fund law. Well, we have more on that coming up in a moment when we return. Stay with us.
Hello again. In more news tonight, the Center for Child Development Research and Referral Center in Cape Coast is bedeviled with lack of space to accommodate more children with special needs. The center is therefore calling for more support from organizations and government.
The Center for Child Development Research and Referral was established in 1974 to provide educational assessment and intervention for children with special needs. Currently, it organizes workshops for teachers and schools on how to teach and manage children with special needs. It is under the College of Educational Studies at the University of Cape Coast. Inadequate space remains a hindrance to the center. Due to this, it's unable to accommodate more children and discharge its duties as expected. A new and bigger facility is needed to be able to run assessment, intervention and audiology services to children with special needs.
A lot of parents are coming in with their children who have special needs and who need one-on-one to help them reach their potential educationally. But because of lack of space, we cannot take them all in.
The center also needs a vehicle to improve its daily activities since it operates on a pull-out basis.
Our sister departments in the college are helping us out free of charge with vehicles to convey the children. But we are having challenges such that sometimes the vehicles break down and parents have sent their children to school expecting that we'll go for them. And then we only have to call them while they are at work to disappoint them, to make other arrangements for their children. And this is not conducive for their parents.
The major challenge with children with special care is stigmatization.
Most of the parents are not willing to seek educational intervention for their children who have special education needs, especially those that are not visible, like those with learning problems. They feel there'll be so much societal stigma, labeling, rejection, and so on and so forth. And in fact, mostly when parents are told of having a child with special education needs, some end up in divorce and then others to separation because they can't deal with it.
Though the University of Cape Coast provides the center with learning materials, authorities say more hands are needed.
Now let's turn to a more contentious issue. And the Member of Parliament for Keta, Richard Kwashigan, says he will consider a court action over Parliament's approval of the 2017 budget in court. Richard Kwashigan is reported to have explained some policy directions in the budget violate the 1992 constitution. He said the decision to cut down statutory payment to the District Assembly Common Fund is a clear violation of Article 2522, which states that at least 5% of the annual government revenue be ceded to the fund. Parliament on March 15 approved the government's 2017 budget presented to the House. Some minority MPs protested over certain portions of the budget as well as actions of the Speaker. That notwithstanding, the House approved the budget. Keta MP Richard Kwashiga is quoted to have said a budget that breaks the law cannot be allowed to stand. Right, so this is the contentious issue tonight, and I'm joined here in the studio by Richard Kwashiga, who is making that claim. Richard, good to see you. Welcome good to News 360. Right. So, in the mind of the public, why would you go to court over what the people will consider a small matter, Richard?
It's not a small matter at all.
Why?
Because we have a place upon ourselves, laws that guide us. And it was the same laws that puts those who are in the helm of affairs today in where they are. And so we need to abide by these laws. And the president pledged to strictly uphold the laws of Ghana. And that is a position we've placed him in as president of Ghana. And he has to do exactly that. If we cannot safeguard this constitution, then we cannot have a state that is in one piece and that will maintain law and order.
But you know, the MPP has dismissed your claim and they say it doesn't constitute any breach.
Well, that is their perspective, that's their view.
What is your perspective? Tell us, why do you think there is a breach? Tell us.
Of course, I have the constitution right here with me. Article 252.
Yeah.
Says that subject to the provisions of this constitution, Parliament shall annually make provision for the allocation of not less than 5% of the total revenues of Ghana to the district assemblies for development, and the amount shall be paid into the district assemblies common fund in quarterly installments.
Right, so what is the total revenue for Ghana?
The total revenue that we'll,
we
have actually projected for is 44.9 billion.
Right.
That includes grants. But you see, before I proceed, I'd want to support these with the District Assemblies Act 455.
Yes.
Which says that total, section 17 of it says, total revenue means all revenues collected by or accruing to the central government other than foreign loans, grants, non-tax revenue, and revenues already collected or for district assemblies under any enactment in force. Now, so that is what total revenue is.
Right.
It excludes grants, loans, and etc.
Right.
But then it includes revenues such as the petroleum revenues. Monies that we generate from, or we're expecting from petroleum, and all that, they are part of it. Now, what our friends in government,
the president,
the president has brought to Parliament,
yes,
they are basing it largely on tax revenue. Now, out of that 44.9 billion, if you take out the 1.9 billion grants,
right,
we're left with 43 billion. The 43 billion, if you work out the 5% of it, which is supposed to go to the district assemblies, it will come up to 2.1 billion. Now, they are basing their arithmetic on what is referred to as tax revenue. And tax revenue will therefore mean that they are, instead of using total revenue, they are using tax revenue by deducting tax refund, deducting allocations that are supposed to be made to GRE, which is supposed to be 2.8%, and then petroleum revenue. All these ought to be part of the total revenue.
But Richard, don't you think there's a difference in figures? Because they are talking about 35 billion. right? So, but you are talking about 44. The figure you have mentioned is 44. But the majority says it is 35 billion.
Yes, because they are basing on tax revenue.
And they are going to make their deductions, and that will even bring it to about 31 billion. And when they calculate the 5%, it will be 5.09%, even more than the 5% you are talking about, right?
Now, one point. Now, you see,
yeah,
that's why I said that they are basing their calculations on what is referred to as tax revenue.
Yeah.
You know, and tax revenue will mean that taking out certain components, including petroleum revenue, which ought not to be the case if you go by our laws. You know, and then per the Act 455, total revenue does not exclude these ones that they have excluded, yeah, which limits it to what is being referred to as tax revenue. That the calculation must not be based on that. Now, I know that the Minister for Monitoring and Evaluation, Dr. Okutose, has alluded to the fact that that's the same way it was done in the past.
Yes.
Well, I don't know about that. But if that was how it was done in the past, and it was wrong, we must not allow the wrong thing to continue in perpetuity.
Right.
We
must do what is right. Can't this correction be made in Parliament instead of going to court? What is the difficulty? Why can't you do it in Parliament?
Because we have raised the argument. The minority had raised the argument. You see, in Parliament, the majority will always can have their way, but they must allow the minority to have their say. We do not think that we're even giving enough room to actually drum home these points. And we also think that if part of the Constitution of Ghana is being breached, we must not allow it. So we're supposed to safeguard the Constitution.
Right.
And so we need some interpretation. And the interpretation can only be gotten from the Supreme Court.
So when do you want to go to court?
All things being
equal. Or is it conditional? Is it based on some conditions?
Oh, all things being equal, we should be heading to court tomorrow or Wednesday.
Have you addressed the Speaker?
Well, the Speaker was the one who was in the seat when the budget was passed, was approved.
Right. So you go to court on Monday?
Hopefully. We all things being equal. Our lawyers have been looking at it, and the fact sheets have been put together.
Right.
And hopefully, all things being equal, we should be heading to court tomorrow or latest Wednesday thereabout.
Right. Richard, nice having you and good talking to you. Richard says he will go to court. So TV3 cameras will be following him right to the court. Which court are you going? Is it the Supreme Court? Right. So we will go and seek interpretation and follow and pick up the story, and because Richard is claiming there is an abuse of the District Assembly Common Fund law. Right, so we'll be following Richard to court on Monday to get the details for you. Now let's turn to some other stories tonight. And the President of the Republic, Nana Addo Dankwa Akufo-Addo, has left Accra to attend the 5th edition of the Africa CEO Forum, which will take place in Geneva, Switzerland. The forum will bring together CEOs of the largest African and international companies, political decision makers from more than 40 African countries and investors on the continent. Whilst there, President Akufo-Addo will also hold meetings with the Executive Director of UNAIDS, Michael Sidibe, and the Swiss Minister for Economic Affairs, Johann Schneider Amann, and also with the Ghanaian community in Geneva. Now, the President is expected to return home in March, on March 23, 2017. That wouldn't be long, so we're still waiting to see our President. You're watching News 360. The news will return shortly with the latest from the world of sports, but you can find out what happened between Accra House of Folk and Kumasi Asante Kotoko this afternoon. Stay with us when we return. We have entertainment coming up next. And contestants of this year's edition of Talented Kids brought their best act to the game when they had the opportunity to choose their own themes.
After weeks of themed events, contestants of Talented Kids Season 8 had the opportunity to do a self-selected act. With celebrated actor Echo Smith Asante as a guest judge, variety, they say, is the spice of life. Hence, the kids chose their own themes and some even did their own renditions of some popular acts. The microphone magicians had a good feel with their soothing voices. The rap gods did not take it easy on the lyrical rhymes and battle. For the dancers, it was a time to show off. And as expected, turntable magician DJ Switch brought down the roof of the house with her electrifying scratches.
1999, Ashanti International, rough and wild.
The bands were not left out of the fan. However, West End band and Lottie Green had to say goodbye to the rest of the contestants as they took a bow out of the competition. Regardless, others walked away with some prizes. With 40 more acts to go, the kids are not leaving any stone unturned to clinch their spot in the finals. Talented kids, free to play. It's a beautiful day.
And that's it for this edition of News 360. We have more updates on News at 10 and also on our website, 3news.com. But right after the News 360, Portia, we have
Bridges of Love.
I'm sure I'm not going to miss this. And so, Portia, so watch it wherever you are. My name is Issa Moni.
And I am Portia Gabo. Enjoy the rest of our programs. Good night.